Kubor Kabate City TV Lawanda Shapi Daka Orange Nissan Looms Hopo near Fire Brigade Shillong Ringkat Bakanet Foodish Order Mapi Ninwan Ramangi Hakker Dog Ying Jongpi
Ka Seng Congress Kabashong Hakalyang Persha Jongpi Ying Dorbar Tao Ain Kajilla Kalapun Pau Yaging Snokia Kabajor Halor Kajing Sapriang Stet Jong Uknyang Jingpang COVID 19 Shakishnong Nongkendong Undang ilam jong kaliang persya Dr. Mukul Sangma habaya keren bat kilat patai kubor ula ong. Baka kongres kadawa ya ke sorkar jela baka daiban penjor ya ke jingle random testing sya kishnong nong kendong kenang ban labdin ya uknyang jingpang COVID-19 ubalong unong shun ubare. Ula ong baka third wave kam slam syo ba uknyang jingpang COVID-19 unsawan linshop hakani ke jela Meghalaya lada ke sorkar kampenstet ya ke jing ai dawai tika ya ki paibba anong shong shnong jong ke jela. Haka jing ya keren berkilat patai kubor Dr. Mukul Sangma ula bo jing keliru ya ke sorkar jela halor ke jing penjelan ya ke jing ai dawai tika haka sen ke baar. Hadin baki paibba kila pendep ya ke jing ai dawai tika haka sen ke beningkong.
The concern about whatever grievances are being received from the general population. And the concern about inputs which suggest that cases are rising in the rural areas. And the quantum of tests against the reported cases of suspected COVID-19 infections in the rural areas are being seen as inadequate. In absence of adequate testing, we will end up in not being able to identify as to where the virus is hiding. And therefore, the testing becomes crucial. In fact, it is one of the weapons in containing the virus from spreading. Therefore, the CLP observed with concern this particular challenge and where the government needs to ramp up its capability across the state in respect of ensuring adequate testing proportionate to the inputs that is being received by concerned district authorities. Now, we all know that across the state we have infrastructures, we have the network through the CNRD blocks, through the public health centers, through the sub centers, and many other resources which is available under the command of the government. They must be effectively put to use in this regard and get all the necessary inputs so that they are able to respond appropriately. In absence of appropriate inputs, it is only natural that our attention will definitely be not drawn to those areas of concern. Therefore, the government needs to ramp up all the necessary measures that have been put in place. In other words, the measures that have been put in place are not considered adequate. Therefore, it must be ramped up. It is an uphill task. It's a challenging time. The demand to cope with the challenges will always be there. Therefore, continuous review and auditing of this is a must, based on which the corrective, ramping up wherever necessary, and optimally utilizing the resources of the government, optimally utilizing the manpower under the command of the government is very, very crucial. We must have a very, very realistic approach, a very, very scientific approach. In regard to non-availability of any support for the households who are affected whenever areas are declared as containment zone, restricting the movement of the people. Now, we all are aware as to how, when an area is declared as a containment zone or micro-containment zone, it is always not with an advance notice. It is on the basis of the number of positive cases following various testing protocols based on the inputs received regarding the likely incidence of the cases, the disease. And the moment positive cases are detected to certain percentage of the numbers of the total patients tested, areas of concern are notified as containment or micro-containment zone, following the proper SOPs. Now what happens to the residents, that was what was being articulated to us by all those members of the society, the local public leaders, various social organizations. There is sudden dislocation of economic activities, number one. But the most difficult position to which they are put in place is regarding sudden disruption of access to essential commodities, particularly in rural areas where there is no grocery shops in the localities, in the villages, where people have to walk miles to reach to the nearest market, nearest grocery shop. And what happens when they cannot come out from the house, from the locality, from the villages? Because people don't have advance storage of the provisions. Therefore, there is a need for the government to understand this hardship to which the people are put to, the hardship to which the people are subjected to, whenever we need to embark upon these measures to contain the spread of virus. The people who are residing in those villages which are declared or notified as containment zone obviously become the victim of the disaster. As per the definition of the victim of disaster under the Disaster Management Act 2005, what happens when you mitigate a problem of other natural calamities? Say, for example, a flash flood, when people have to be shifted and shelter in relief camps, the onus of responsibility of providing the general relief is vested with the authorities, with the government. So, COVID-19 pandemic has been notified under the same act. Therefore, when we are notifying COVID-19 as a disaster under the provision of the Disaster Management Act, the victims obviously are required to be covered in consistent with the provision of the Act. That means the victims must be taken care of. Here the victims include the patients who have been diagnosed with the disease and also the families, the households who are affected whenever a locality or a village is notified as containment zone. So therefore the government has been found wanting in addressing this concern of the people. I have had talked to many of the leaders, many of the headmen, the nokmas of different villages, and they have expressed their anguish, they have expressed their helplessness, and the quantum of sufferings that they are going through. Therefore, it is only in the fitness of things that the government take cognizance of this problem. Government understand their responsibility in consistent with the provisions of the law, as to the mandate of the law. In addition to this, since the cases are reported to be spreading in the rural areas, we have to see how we can minimize the suffering of the people during this second wave and how we can contain the spread of the disease. so that we don't end up seeing the mutant variant emerging from our own backyard, in our own school. And thereby, somehow, see ourselves unprepared to take on the challenges of any third, impending, inevitable third wave. There's another matter of concern. Now, looking at the trend as to how the virus is mutating, we for sure know that we have to be prepared to face the inevitable third wave of the pandemic. And when we are talking about the likely emergence of the third wave, when and how fast is a question. Now, look at the vaccine policy of the government. The interval or the gap between the first jab and the second jab, which was earlier indicated at 6 to 7 weeks, have been increased to 12 to 16 weeks. And when we try to look at the reason for this sudden increase between the first dose and the second dose, we could not find any scientific answer. There is no scientific answer in as far as this gap is concerned. Therefore, the state government must take up this issue with Government of India. We must be realistic and we must be scientific. It cannot be based on somebody's whims and fancies. We cannot deviate from ground reality. We cannot deviate from whatever is considered realistic based on scientific understanding, based on scientific data. Now, therefore, even if you're looking at this gap of 12 to the designated gap, the revised gap, spreading from 12 to 16 weeks, it's a long gap between the first and the second jab. That means by next 12 and 16 weeks also you will not have enough number of the population covered by two doses of vaccines. That means you will not have the population who are fully equipped with the right kind of arsenal in the instant case through vaccination to face the challenge of this pandemic. To face the kind of challenge of the pandemic wherein we need to minimize the brunt of the pandemic on the overall health infrastructure and health facilities and minimize the number of sufferings and loss of precious lives. Will the virus wait for 12 and 16 weeks to show its resurgence in the third wave? We don't know. We hope that it doesn't happen at all. But the trend indicates that it might strike at any point of time. And therefore, this particular vaccine policy strategy, I have tweeted today on this regard, reflecting my concern that nation as a whole is likely to be found unprepared to face the onslaught of the inevitable third wave. Because of this revised vaccine policy, wherein the people who have received first jab will have to wait for 12 to 16 months, yes, 16 weeks. But if we see the third wave striking sooner than that, that means the whole population will be seen unprotected, uncovered by the vaccine. So this must be taken up at an appropriate, with an appropriate amount of seriousness with Government of India, and prevail upon Government of India to take a call which should be guided by complete scientific interpretation and not by anybody's individual opinion or strategy. The uncontrolled spike in essential commodities pricing pattern across the state. Edible oil which are available at 100 rupees and below 100 rupees are being sold at 200 rupees. Now you have to understand that people have very limited cash reserve. The population, the citizens don't have surplus investable reserve to be subjected to this kind of uncontrolled price rise. I don't see any measure or any effort from the side of the government to take cognizance of this concern. Whose job it is to regulate the market pricing? Is it a complete manipulation of the market through understanding or otherwise? We have to know. It's very difficult to reconcile with this kind of uncontrolled price rise, which is showing only increasing graph. Talk about the diesel prices, talk about the petroleum prices, everything, except the prices when farmers have to sell their own perishable produce. It is just the other way around. What is the price that farmers are fetching for their ginger this time? What is the price that the farmers are fetching their price? Or what is the price that farmers have to sell their perishable produce from the farms, farm products? The price of the ginger, the price of the turmeric. It's just the reverse. The month of April and May, the price of the turmeric was just below 10 rupees. Fresh turmeric in the rural areas, in the villages. The price of the ginger. But when it comes to purchasing essential commodities, irony is that the prices have spiked in terms of 100%, 50%. Who is going to protect the interests of the people? You ask every household, probably the mothers, they will tell you the agony of seeing their hard-earned money and the money which they have probably saved for all their possible important family agendas, educating their children, preparing for their children's marriage, so many things, saving their money for completing their houses. Look at the price of cement, look at the price of the steel, look at the price of the CGI sheets. What is the price? Why is it skyrocketing? Who is benefiting out of this? Is there a mafia all across the nation who is operating? Or is it that government, because they want to illegally extort from the public, because, you know, the GST is in terms of percentage, 18%. If the price goes up, the tax also goes up. You see? Then someday you will see government saying, oh, you had a good collection of GST. How? By increasing the prices? By allowing this unchecked, unregulated, uncontrolled price rise across the nation? Across the state? This is how we expect the government to say that they are responsible to take interest of the to take cognizance of the interests of the people. I think we are looking at a situation where people are just thinking that, okay, we are all helpless when the price of various commodities, including, you know, building materials. You're talking of providing home to the homeless, low-cost houses. People trying to, you know, build a respectable dwelling houses from their hard-earned money. Suddenly they go to market and tell me, sir, the price has gone up. Everything. Who is going to protect us? Who is going to protect the people? The citizen. Nobody is talking. You have so many cement factories in the state and you pay the price of cement which is If you compare, you find out what is the cement being sold in other states, where they have cement manufacturing factories. And here, you have so many cement factories, and the price escalation has never stopped since last 2 years. Is anybody getting benefit out of that? I think this is something which we must investigate. We must investigate who is benefiting out of this price, uncontrolled price rise. I see lots of poor families buying one bag cement, two bag cement, slowly taking care of their incomplete construction. And they come and tell, "Sir, the price of cement has gone up." Friends, it's time when people in authority must understand their responsibility of protecting the interests of the people.